Yeah,
got it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good energy.
Yeah.
Did you all atone this week? Did a few of you atone this week? I was supposed to do a book talk on Tuesday night, which is Yom Kippur Kol Nidrei, and I was like, no, I don't think that's going to be very well attended, so we moved it to Monday on the west side of the Bell. But here we are at the end of launch week, and it's great to be back with all of you in Medina Bay, Pasadena. I am one of the original gangsters, Andy Wilson. Where is he? I know he's out there somewhere. Andy is out there. There's Andy. Andy invited me early on in the process of Innovate to come and talk with you, and we talked on the subject of mentorship. In fact, is T here? We did a real-time transformation of T on the stage. Who was there? Who saw that? A few of you, yeah? It was transformational. In fact, he's still healing from that. So we'll do that again sometime. You know, it's I guess that puts me in kind of a rare group, being a second bench speaker here. But I feel like this is my home turf now. In fact, I'll introduce you to a friend. The timing is incredible. I have a board that I'm on for a startup. It's started to get some momentum. It's called the Good Men Project. Anybody familiar with the Good Men Project? An editorial site. And the CEO, Lisa Hickey, is in the back. Lisa, raise your hand. Everybody say hi to Lisa. Welcome her. And she's actually going to be in residence here across campus. So we get to not only talk the talk, but walk the walk with new companies. So this does feel like home for me. I come about once a month when I'm in town, and I love talking with all of you about various things. Today, that various thing will be the release of my new book, and as you said, it is on sale here. And please don't do what so many people do, which is come to the book talk, enjoy it, and then see that it's slightly less priced online and buy it there, because we have to support our local bookstores or we're not going to have local bookstores. Somebody asked me at a reading the other day, they said, what shelf in the store will I find your book on? I said, just find the bookstore. Just get to the bookstore. They will help you find the book. We've got to support these stores. So a lot of what I'm going to talk about today in the book, and I'm going to read to you, is on this theme of reinvention and resilience, and I think it's appropriate to talk about that here at Innovate Pasadena, because what are we now, Andy, 2 years into this? 2 years, and it literally started out with you having coffee with what, a couple, four or five people?
Jones's back room.
Jones, and migrated to another coffee shop, migrated. For a while, you had to actually go online to see where we were gonna meet, because it changed everybody. It was sort of like, you know, follow the meeting. Sometimes you'd have a screen, sometimes you wouldn't have a screen, sometimes you'd have a microphone, sometimes you wouldn't have a microphone. And then we found our way over to the convention center lobby, and the Starbucks baristas are still crying over the fact that we've left them there, but we were there for a long time. And now we're here across campus, which is a home of innovation. So just to see that spirit of reinvention and resilience running through this organization, it really feels good, and it feels good to see all of you and to see all of you growing. So I'll ask you a real simple question in the spirit of getting some exercise with your limbs. How many of you out there have had what you would consider to be your first big success? How many have had their first big success? Good hands. And how many of you would have what you would consider to be a second success? Okay, for the camera that's not recording viewer. How many would you say you've had multiple over and over again, many, many, many successes? All right, we got some repeat success people out there. Now I'll ask you the other side of that question. How many of you have had a knockdown, drag out, can't believe it, left in the road, run over by all four tires, wipe out, failure? Oh, come on, be honest. And how many of you have had two of those knockdown, wipe out, crap out failures? Yeah. And how many of you have had lots of those wipe out, drag out, knockdown failures? Now, how many of you that I just asked those two questions, you raise your hand in both the success and the failure mode? Raise your hands. Okay, so that's the overlap. That's what we're talking about today, is how those two things come together. And that's what Encores is about. How many of you are waiting for your first start, your big start win? I mean, haven't had the first win yet? Great. And keep your hands. And how many of those who haven't had the first big win yet have had the first big lose? They've had the first big failure. Hang in there. You're on the cusp. You're going to turn the corner. Trust me, you're going to turn the corner. The only problem is, I can't tell you when. But all of us who have had any success at all have had those failures. You know, the interesting thing is when they introduced you, and I started on this book tour about 2 months ago, I got introduced to someone who's had nothing but successes. And that was just like so untrue. I mean, it just made me wince. I just don't put those in my bio. I mean, if I put all the failures in the bio with the successes, the thing would be like 4 pages long, you know? No, our bios are short because those are the things that we call out and we celebrate. Those are the things that allow us to have the career. But the failures, the things, the places where we go astray, those are the things that we learn from that let us have the successes. And anybody who's been in this game for a couple of decades knows that. It's not just about successes, and hopefully it's not just about failures, but it's about the combination of the two of those that let you be resilient and let you reinvent and go, as we say in the book, for repeat success with people, products, and profits, which I'll talk about today. So today's agenda, what I'd like to do is just tell you a little bit about why I wrote Endless Encores, and then I'll read to you. How many people have never been to a book reading before? Be honest. Cool. That's another thing, you're experiencing something the first time. I'm actually going to read you a story just like your parents did when you were small. Hopefully I'll make you remember how good that feels to have your parents read to you. And then I'll take some questions, and then if you want to hang around afterwards and buy some books from Nice People Romans, I'll sign those, make a good Christmas gift. Rage actually makes a great doorstop. A lot of pages, a lot of heft there. So it's a multi-purpose. So why did I write Endless Encores? As was mentioned, I do consider myself a corporate refugee. I've had a few different careers. CEO of a startup that was sold. For that, I was a senior executive at Disney. For that, I was a senior executive at a company called Broadway. Now we'll see if we have some age in the audience. How many people remember CD-ROM? How many people remember making money off of CD-ROM? Yeah, it was good. It was great. You put that box on the shelf for $50. It cost you $1 in cost of goods. Good gross margins. So I was in the company that did games like Carmen Sandiego that were of that generation. And it was great. I had a lot of fun with all of that. But when I started in life, I started as a writer. And I got out of it through a series of accidents, which I'll tell you about one-on-one sometime if you're interested, or maybe on my next time here. But my wife, after we sold shop.com, said, you know, what happened to that writer in you that I used to know? And you know, you're not getting any younger. That 50th birthday does wake you up. Oh, great, I just admitted it on video. So I set out to write the first novel, and I didn't set out to write a 530-page opus covering everything from media and technology to entertainment and finance, politics, the crashing of the stock market, how startups start, how startups fail. But when you sit down at the keyboard, sometimes that comes out. And I was happy with the process. I was very, very happy with my publisher. I had an independent publisher who was terrific. But at the end of that book, I was exhausted. It really was a lot of work to get all of that to come together. And when you write a long book, you write it multiple times. So it's not just writing a short book multiple times, it's writing a long book multiple times. And then you go out, you do the book tour, you do all that. And then the other thing you learn when you publish a book now is you have to do social media every single day, because if somebody sends you a note from, you know, Africa, you have to respond to it. And they don't know that there's a time difference. They send you a note telling your book is good. If you don't respond to it, they go online and say nasty things about you. So you have to respond to these things sort of all the time while you're ostensibly writing your next book. So I knew that I had to write another book, because that's what Lou, my publisher, said. Now that we have your name out there and you know, we've broken you as a writer, what are you going to write? And the idea of doing another book like Rage, I just couldn't even like get my head around it. So about the same time that I started this writing career 4 or 5 years ago, I started my blog, Corporate Intel. How many of you guys have looked at my blog before? Good. CorporateIntel.us. I publish about 2 times a month, and I publish on the topic of business. And I got a pretty good following, and when I looked up when Rage was done, I had about 125 entries of about 1,000 to 1,500 words, and I said, there must be a book in there. I said, why don't I just take those blog entries and curate them and turn them into a collection, and that'll be my second book, because that'll be sort of easier than writing a brand new book. So of course, Lou said you can't do that because you already gave that away for free. You can't sell that as a book. But if you did some wraparound material and tied the blog entries together, we could do that. So I said, great, I'll do that. I'll write some wraparound material and I'll tie the 125 episodes of Learning from Business together and I'll have a new book. And then something really interesting happened. I wrote these little character sketches for these two characters, Daphne and Paul. Daphne was the veteran CEO who had sort of seen it all, done it all, been there. Been successful, failed. And Paul, the up-and-coming manager, some of you who raised your hand earlier, who had just had his first success, but was crapping out with his second project was not going to be a success, was going to be a failure. And the two of them meet in an airport lounge. And I say, I know, I'll kind of make them like the Muppets. They'll sit in the gallery and they'll talk about my blog entries. And that'll be my second book. I'll have them do the interstitial material. Seemed like a good idea. I probably could knock it out in a year. Plus, I was adapting Rage for the stage, so that seemed like that would be a good year. Except that I started to like Daphne and Paul more than I liked the stuff that I already written, because when we're reinventing ourselves, what is in front of us now is always going to be more interesting to us than something that we've already done. And so I said, you know, I think I'm going to stay with Daphne and Paul, and I think I'm going to stay with the themes of the blog, but I'm going to throw away the blog entries, and I'm going to write just that book, and the interstitial material became the actual book. And that's how I went started down the path. Well, then something even more interesting happened. I was at a New Year's party, end of 2013, and right here in La Cañada. A friend of mine's home, they have one of the most wonderful wine cellars, I think in all of La Cañada, Pasadena. And that night, this particular friend had decided to drink half of what was in the wine cellar. And he called me over, and said, I read your first book, it was really great, you know. He says, but you know, can I give you some advice? Can I tell you what a real book is? And I'm like, God, this is gonna be great. So, he said, have you ever read The 1 Minute Manager? And I said, no. But you're going to tell me about it, aren't you? Oh, The 1 Minute Manager, this is great. It's like you can solve all the problems of business in 1 minute and catch people doing something right and, you know, give feedback in 1 minute, whether they're doing good or they're bad. And I'm like, oh, that's a book. Okay. So I went home and I looked up The 1 Minute Manager, and it was published about the year I graduated from high school. I graduated high school in 1980, this was published in 1981. And everything he had said to me was true, except he had forgotten to say one thing. It had sold 13 million copies, and it was really, really small. And I said, wow, you can write a book that's really, really small, and you can sell 13 million copies. You guys are still selling this thing, aren't you? Yeah, they're still selling it. So I said, yeah, this business parable thing, this thing could be okay. I'm gonna do that. But here was the thing, and I do fashion myself a serious writer. And I said to Lou, my publisher, I said, if I write something in the form of The 1 Minute Manager, is it okay if I write it well? Is it okay if the story and characters are good? Because there's a lot of great advice in this book. Don't get me wrong. In fact, I wrote a blog entry about it. It's a terrific book. But the characters are not people that you meet in real life, and I write about characters that you meet in real life. And he said, oh, I got it. You want to write a business parable that's actually decent fiction. Go for it. So I said, that sounded like a challenge. He said, the only problem is, he says, you're going to develop these characters, you're going to develop this story, you got to do it in 35,000 words. I was like, wow, 35,000 words. Rage was 172,000 words. Not a problem, boss. And I thought, wow, it has to be easier to write 35,000 words than it is to write 172,000 words. except that it's not. And all of that concern about being able to do it in the amount of time I had with all the ideas that I wanted to share started to flow through me in a way that I wanted to make it real to all of you. I wanted to make it a truly felicitous entry, but I wanted to make it a good story. I wanted to make it all those things that we talked about. So I had to wrap it around a concept that I thought would be accessible to all of you. And I had been listening to a lot of people at this forum and at other forums. I mentor a lot of young CEOs now. I mentor a lot of re-emerging CEOs now. And the theme that kept emerging over and over as I talked to people was, how do we not run out of successes? How do we not fall into the trap where our last success is our last success? And for someone who hasn't had the first success yet, that probably sounds like a problem that you want to have. And it is a problem that I'm sure you're going to have, but it is an equal or more powerful problem than getting to that first success, because we find out that our failures are easy to replicate. If you do the same wrong thing over and over again, right, you will get the same bad result. But if you try to do the same thing that succeeded for you before, it's no longer unique. It's no longer special, and so you can't replicate that success. And I thought a lot about some of the real world corollaries. I thought a lot about the Eagles. You know the band The Eagles, Hotel California? You guys remember Hotel California? A few nods out there, right? Do you remember how big that record was? I mean, is it conceivable how big that record was? And what did they do afterwards? The staring at each other, the infighting, the frozenness, and then the power to go back into the studio and do the long run. How did they get there? I thought about, in my own experience, Rand and Robin Miller, who created Myst, which at the time was the best-selling CD-ROM game of all time, and the most beautiful CD-ROM game of all time, most engaging story CD-ROM game of all time. We had no idea. We thought, you know, well, we sell 100,000 copies on Mac, it'll be cool. You know, the darn thing went out and did 10 million units. These guys were living in a double wide when that game came out. And they literally went from rags to riches in the course of one game. Mind you, it was their fourth game. The three before that, although beautiful pieces of work, beautiful pieces of art, didn't sell. And so there they were, staring at themselves, trying to find the place, trying to find the strength to go back into the studio again and muster the creativity, muster the process to do Riven, which was the sequel to Myst, which, although it was the sequel to Myst, they absolutely refused to frame it as a sequel. They wanted to frame it as something new and different. And we came out with Riven, and surprise, surprise, it outsold Myst. That was their talent, that was their process. I thought about a lot, and talked a lot in the book about the one-hit wonders, right? What happened to Kung Fu Fighting, right? What happened to Tainted Love, right? It's good to see people my age laughing. There are more. Why were those one-hit wonders? And why are the Eagles the Eagles? And why are the Beatles, and why is Paul McCartney Paul McCartney? I talk about Paul McCartney in the book. Paul, how many people saw Paul at Dodger Stadium here last year? It was amazing. He played 3 hours, he played 39 songs, but the most interesting thing that he did in the 39 songs that he played was he played four brand new pieces of material in front of 55,000 people. This is Paul McCartney. He doesn't have to do it. He could play hits all night long. He could play hits for 10 hours and not run out of songs. But he's a musician first, and he knows if he's going in front of an audience, there has to be new material. He doesn't ever want to be perceived as a one-hit wonder. So I thought about this concept of bringing that into this parable, into this one-minute manager-like book, into this concept of fearing repeat success. And there was only one thing missing, which was, what was the glue that I was going to use to hold it together? And again, talking with all of you and working with the various entrepreneurs that I work with and the various former team members that I work with who are now running their own companies, they all came back to me and said the same thing. They said, Ken, you gotta go out and tell other people about people, products, profits in that order. That's the message of the book that will allow people to have a career of repeat success. People, products, profits. Well, what do I mean by that? Well, that isn't just a slogan for me. That's not just something we slapped on the front of the book. For those of you, who are working with me and those of you who worked with me before, that's how I've done it. That's how I put the failures behind me and gotten back to the successes. That's what I'm doing with Lisa right now on the Good Men Project. That's what I'm doing with my colleagues up in Seattle on Thrift Books. And it starts with people. It starts with the right talent. Now, a lot of companies will say our people are our most valuable asset, right? You hear that all the time. You see that poster on the door, and then they announce the 20% layoff, and everybody sees that sign as they're walking out the door. It's not a word. Talent is real. You cannot be successful without talent, and you cannot be successful without talent working well together. Very, very, very few of us in this age, in the digital age, can do this on your own. You want to write a book? Fine, you can go write a book on your own. There still will be other people involved, but that's as close as it gets. You want to do anything in technology, you want to do anything in manufacturing, you want to do anything in any of these information age things, you're going to be working with people. So it's not just about your talent. It's about assembling the talent and creating the culture and the environment where people can work together. And this is a walk that I walk because every time you hire, you make a critical decision. John Huston said, the film director said the most important part of making a movie is casting. Because if I get that right, all I have to do is say action and marvelous. If I put the wrong people in the picture, hey, right? It's never gonna be any good. So picking the right people, picking the right people who will work together well and creating that environment is the foundation. If you want repeat success, keep going back to people. Reassemble the team that will work for you and create that magic. There is no other shortcut. If you have the wrong people in the room, your next product will be a duck. There's no question about it. Which brings us to number two, which is product. What does product mean? Right? Does it mean getting something in a box and getting it on the shelf? Does it mean hitting a release date and pushing the code live to the site? No. It means pushing your team and pushing yourself to a level of creativity and innovation that leapfrogs what's out there right now. Not adds two or three little tiny features and some people are like, come look at my app, it does this, it does that. No, it needs to reinvent the world. And I'm not saying you're gonna reinvent the world every time, but if you strive to reinvent the world with that new product, you will do something better than you thought you were going to do. We will have products that matter. There are so many products that are coming out, that the product cycle, they are forgotten almost the day that they are launched. You put all of that time into it and you put it out there and you go, nobody downloaded my app. Nobody downloaded your app because nobody needed it. Nobody downloaded your app because you didn't leapfrog what was out there. Don't say it's about the app store, okay? If you've got something that's magical, people will find it. I look at that, keep looking at Lisa here. I mean, when we started the Good Men Project, you know, what do we have, 4 or 5 articles a day? Nobody came. We've got 3 to 5 million uniques now. We're publishing 30 times a day. That didn't happen overnight. That's 5 years of learning, of finding a voice for that site. And she's still at it, and she's still at it. But she's honing that product, she's honing that voice, she's finding a story to tell that somebody else isn't telling. And that's what you need to do with your product. A product can't be ordinary. Focus relentlessly on the extraordinary. As I said, you will fail more times than you succeed, but all you have to do to have those hands that were raised at the beginning of this talk is 2 or 3 big wins over the course of a career. And you've got a career, and you can come up here and sell a book. But you got to focus on the extraordinary. You got to have those magical products. And then third, profits. What do I mean by profits? I mean a sane business model, okay? Not, hey, we raised $20 million of cash and we have 20 months of runway. We have to have a sane business model so at the end of the cash, the business is producing the cash that will allow us to continue. Now, what's the corollary of that? What's the other side of that? The other side of that is, let's just go make a ton of dough, right? We'll go come up with this clever concept, and then we'll put it out there, we'll put some good marketing against it, and we'll make a ton of money, right? That's cynical. That's just financial engineering. You might get lucky, you might win the lottery, but you won't have repeating success, because a business model is part of the process, but it's not all of the process. And so those are the three things that I've been evangelizing now for 30 years that have let me have some of those successes and along the way many failures to learn from. But that's been my mission. That's what I focused on: people, products, profits, in that order. Get the right people, create the right environment, force the innovation to a level that leapfrogs the market, and make sure that there's the same business model sitting under it. So that was the glue: people, products, profits, to do the business parable, to unseat the one-minute manager in 35,000 words or less. That's all I set out to do, and so the idea that writing those 35,000 words, if you think, is going to be easier than writing 172,000 words, let me buy you a drink, because it won't be the last one that you have. But here we are, and I have a wonderful, wonderful support team that's been out marketing it. My publicist is here today, and she's been great, getting us great stories and great hits out there. The nice people from Romans are going to be reading at Romans, for anybody who missed this talk, giving a similar talk October 27th. And with your permission, would you like to have me read to you like your parents read to you when you were small?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Because you're not
going
to finish the sleep, right?
I'll try not to put you to sleep. There is coffee available in the back. If I put you to sleep, I'll buy you the coffee. All right, so I'm going to read you. How am I doing on time? Okay? Good? All right. Yep. Good? Yep. All right. So I'm going to read to you from the one early in the book when I mentioned the two main characters, Daphne and Paul. And yes, right up front, Daphne is the CEO, and we need more characters like Daphne. So when you write your book, make sure that the senior management is reflective of the diversity of our shared culture, because it is important. And there are great, great, great women CEOs rising up, and we want to see more of them. So Daphne meets Paul in an airport lounge, and Paul is staring into a glass of red wine and not a very happy camper, and this is how they meet. Paul barely noticed when a woman, apparently in her mid-60s, took the corner seat beside him. His face was buried in his mobile phone, scrolling through alternative flights to connect through other cities, none of which were likely to get him home sooner. She was well-dressed and trim, her shoulder-length hair in perfect order, but at twice his age had been imperial. For all he knew, she was just another executive at the bar ordering a drink. Her taste was scotch. "What's the matter?" she asked without invitation. "The look on your face tells me it's something more than the delayed flight." "It's the delayed flight," he said, scowling at the mobile screen that offered no more news than the flight to LAX was now TBD. That would be the last flight of the night. If it went, it went. If it didn't, the next one would be in the morning. "I checked with the gate agent. They're saying 50-50 for LAX," she said. "How did you know I was going to LA?" he asked. "Lucky guess. I'm pretty good at reading people. My name is Daphne." "I'm Paul Beckett. They told you 50-50? Sounds more like 75-25 against. You're not much of an optimist, are you, Paul?" "The equipment's at the gate, but they wouldn't say what was wrong with it. They offered me the chance to rebook to an earlier morning flight with hotel on the house. I'm sure they'd offer you the same." "I'll take my chances until they cancel," said Paul. "I need to get home." "Family commitment?" asked Daphne. "No, I'm not married. Maybe someday. I have to rescue this new project I launched before we released it. I'm not sure how we're going to fix it." "No, I've been at that report launch party," relayed Daphne. "Are you having a bad year?" Paul wasn't sure why she was asking him so many questions. He hadn't been in the mood to talk, but suddenly he found the words emptying out of him. "No, actually, I've been having a stellar year," answered Paul. 3 good years, to tell you the truth. 3 amazing years. We started this new video game 3 years ago. It stayed in the top 10 since the first week on the charts. That doesn't happen very often." "Sounds tremendously exciting," said Daphne. "I don't know anything about video games, but I do know when they're hits, they make a lot of money for the people who produce them." "Oh yes, barrels of cash delivered without delay to the front door," said Paul. I got a big bonus, stock options. They promoted me to vice president. A year before the release, I was a lowly product manager living in a tiny apartment driving a 10-year-old junkie. 6 months later, I bought a condo with a view and a cool new hybrid. A bounty of treasure, yet you're staring at your sour reflection in a glass of cheap red wine, said Daphne. Doesn't add up. Do you always offer bar school psychotherapy to strangers in airport clubs? Paul wasn't quite sure how the conversation had begun or how she had gotten him to open up so quickly, but Daphne had an impressive presence and seemed to know a bit about business. Well, I figured out that flight delays go a lot more quickly with good conversation, said Daphne. Long flights, too. What do you do? Inquired Paul. I'm with an electronics component company here in the Bay Area, replied Daphne. We manufacture the less visible elements of circuit boards. I came in with the turnaround team about a decade ago, a few years after the company went public and got crushed by overpromising Wall Street. I wasn't sure how we could resuscitate this one, but I saw pockets of strength hiding in the shadows, and I was up for the challenge. We got most of the things that mattered aligned, and the stock recovered nicely. It sounds like you know what you're doing, said Paul. I wish I had your confidence. Well, I've had my ups and downs, like everyone in business, said Daphne. I've learned a few things along the way, and it certainly hasn't been a cakewalk. In this last job, a lot broke right for me, but I think it might be time to do something else. Follow-ups are hard, but reinvention keeps your thinking fresh. Change is always on my mind, certainly at the moment. Can't imagine giving up my job, not willingly, gasped Paul. You really are confident. A job is never yours to give up, said Daphne. It's a box on an organization chart you fill for a while, until someone else fills it, or until the company goes away. It ends when it's time. I don't get it. How is it not my job, asked Paul. Well, if you don't own the company, it's their job, not yours. They lease it to you for a while for the value you create beyond what you cost. At the end of the lease, if you paid off the tab and have more valuable knowledge and skills than when you signed on, it's a good deal for everyone. If you take their money, but you don't get better at what you do, you got burned. It's a scary way of looking at the business world, said Paul. The alternative is to go out on your own, but of course that comes with its own set of costs. There's no easy way to stay in the game. If you're looking for certainty or for shortcuts, forget it. So that's the first meeting between Paul and Daphne. Oh, you're two times. More?
Yeah.
A little bit on people? Okay. So this is from the section on people. Oh, good. Someone actually was inspired to get up and go over what. You good? I'll read you another one. It was getting late in the evening, and as yet there was no additional update on the flight departures. At this point, Paul was sort of hoping it would go that way. To leave this conversation unfinished was not something that held much appeal. What don't I know that I wish I knew? Asked Paul, knowing that didn't exactly come out right. We put everything into this game, everything we had to give, but the end result isn't flourishing. It seems like we're making progress with that wall around you, said Daphne. The truth is, you already know everything you need to know. All I can do is maybe get you to rethink it in a different context. Take me through the project from the beginning. The good one or the follow-up, asked Paul. Why would I want to retrace the path of mediocrity, said Daphne. The good one, the big winner. When did you begin? Where did you begin with the original ethereal gaze? We started with a pitch. We'd been kicking around this concept for a few years, the idea of an enormous war game, galactic in scope, but without a lot of weapons, without any bullets or tactical bombs or spleens exploding. You know, any of that normal shooter stuff that was leaping off the shelf. We said we'd try to do it with clever ideas of strategy, mind-blowing graphics, a full symphonic soundtrack, and characters that made you believe they were real. It sounds visionary. Heck of an agenda for a library of program quotes, said Daphne. You even went against the grain and tried to build something that wasn't a proven big seller. But tell me, and I sort of asked you this before, but it's worth repeating. Who is we? We. The team, said Paul. The core design group, the people I see every day who come up with this stuff. The guys with the ideas who know how to make it happen. That's cool. Now, let me ask you, which came first? The concept or the talent to create it? Why do I think this is a trick question, said Paul. It's not a trick question. Which comes first, the idea or those who offer the idea? It's kind of the starting point, like the chicken and the egg, only we're going to solve it. You can't have an idea without someone expressing it, said Paul, hoping he hadn't said anything too obvious. There you have it. Bullseye, said Daphne. Not just someone expressing it, someone with the ability and training to express it, and then be able to deliver on it. A team or an individual, it doesn't matter. The foundation is the same. Let's talk about talent. I'll try to keep up with you, said Paul. You have a lot of big ideas. Too many people I've encountered over the years in business think it's solely the big idea that matters. Don't get me wrong, big ideas are critical to success. You need spectacular concepts when you envision new products and services you want to bring to market. We'll talk about that. But before you can even think about creating, marketing, distributing, and selling anything of value, you have to have the right people in place to get the job done. Desperate leaders spend too much time worrying first about output. Long-term leaders spend the majority of their time thinking about talent. I don't know about that, replied Paul. I live in a world where customers need to be hugely excited, almost frothing at the mouth, standing in line overnight outside the store, waiting for the product release before it's even on the shelf. Don't flatter yourself. In one way or another, we all do, countered Daphne. Great ideas can be thrilling, but they don't make payroll. Ideas get the ball rolling, but they're overrated. We worry too much about those who would steal them. Getting a product to market that embodies a great idea is what matters, and that's extraordinarily difficult. Products don't build themselves. So those are a couple passages from And I have one more, but I think we're starting to run a little bit late. I want to leave some room for some questions. So any questions or thoughts about anything that I talked about today or about the role in general? Yes?
You have a great voice. Is there an audio version of this?
I think you wait till your sort of first level of sales go through, and then depending on that, if there's enough demand for it, then we do the audio there. But I thank you for the compliment. I'm glad that it's been recorded here on video. I can show it to Lou. Tell them that there's at least one person who wants the audio.
It's been documented.
All right,
we're going to open up for questions. Anybody else have a question for Ken? So it sounds like you're working on the third book now?
Shh, that's a secret. Yes. Writers are always writing on another book. Yes.
I found your parables very interesting, and as an organizational psychologist, I love the fact that you put people first. You're right. Have you done any research on the management stuff, or is this just sort of years of wisdom in the book?
Research in like library, and I didn't go to business school. Somebody asked me before what my degree is in. My degree is in theater and philosophy. Perfect background for technology. When I was at Broderman, they decided to move me from running the creative studio to general management. They sent me to Stanford and said, learn how to balance sheet, income statement, and cash flow work. You have 2 weeks. I came back in 2 weeks and they made me do an earnings call. So no formal research. I guess that the only research I have is the people who call me every day who have been working with me over the course of 30 years. It's my style. It didn't start out that way. I mean, I sort of evolved the style, but the research is real world on the job. How do we get the next, how many of you work for a small public company under 500 million, anybody? When you work for a company like that, a startup that went public, immediately the freak out in the company from private to public is, delivering the quarterly earnings, right? In the first time you miss quarterly earnings, like everyone, your board freaks out, your CEO freaks out, everybody freaks out, Wall Street crushes you, and everybody says, okay, what are we gonna do? And the answer is there's no magic product that you can bring out next quarter that's gonna put your earnings back on. So they come to you and I say, or they come to me and I say, what's your process of product development? Do we have the right talent here? If we don't have the right talent here, it's not gonna work. Do we have the right culture here to cause the talent to want to give us their best, ideas and their best effort? And then what is the product? What's the product on the board? What is the competitive advantage of that product has? And then what is the gross margin on the product? What's the cost to produce? What's the fixed and variable cost structure? I don't see any shortcut to that, and I can't find any shortcut to that. So the answer is, however long it's gonna take us to get that product to market, we can reinvent this company and do it. I guess the only research is, if there's another way to do it, please teach me, because mine is time intensive and often capital intensive, but as I said, over the course of time, we'll produce some results. I'm sure there are some people, I didn't have a chance to read the third passage in the book. In the third passage in the book, there's an investment banker sitting in the bar who's had enough of this, you know, baloney, and says it ain't about that, it's about profits, 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 and profits, stop ruining this kid's life. And some people believe that. And you know what, if you're doing, you know, financial engineering, God love you, you know, if that works for you, that works for you. But it doesn't work for me. So that's the research. The research is School of Hard Knocks. I've jammed those products out there for the quarter, and you know, it's like, you know, the boss says, you have to book this on the last day of the quarter. And how many people know the phrase death march? How many of you have been on a death march, right? How many death marches were successful? Zero, right? Hit the date, get it out. Publish on the last day of the quarter, you book the sales, guess what? On Monday, you book the returns, doesn't work. And I've got my share of products, as I said, I don't put them in the bio because they're too embarrassing, but I will tell you over a glass of wine sometime. Yeah?
I was gonna say, how do we get investment people or the business people to understand that this is a process and
yeah.
It's not financial engineering if you really want something good?
Yeah, you pick your investors very, very carefully. We've had different kinds in this room over the last couple of years, and you can hear it in their voice. You can see it in their track record. There's different kinds. The long-term investors, you can see it in their track record. Look at the companies that they've built. Or look at the companies that they financed and then flipped. It just really, you can tell when you're talking to someone. Although we all think, particularly in a seed round, it's a one-way dialogue. It's not a one-way dialogue, it's a two-way dialogue. You think you have to get the investor to invest in you, but if you take that wrong investment, how many people take the wrong investment capital and pay the price? You know, fear you. I have. It's like dating, it's like anything else, get to know the other person, but all money is not good money. You've got to take the money that works for you. It's important.
Yeah.
This will be the last question.
Can you talk a little about rekindling and sustaining resilience?
Yeah, thank you so much. I think that was a plant. That was a question I love to answer. It's the hardest thing in the world. Particularly as you enter, as we would say, soft middle age, you have to fight just as hard as you did when you were 18, 19, 20 years old. In fact, you might have to fight harder because there's a lot of the 18, 19, 20 year olds who are more nimble and smart and coming up quick. It's really simple. No matter what it says on your resume, no matter what it says in your bio, you let go of that. You put that behind you. You are starting with a blank page. Every new project, the only thing that matters on that new project is the wisdom and knowledge that you bring from what you did before. But nobody's going to buy it. When you bring out a new book, they can say it's by the author of such and such, but if the book is no good, it'll die right out of the gate. Nobody cares. The resilience, the strength to fight is the difference between people who do repeat and the people who don't. I will say that again. The resilience to fight is the difference between the people who will repeat and won't. There are people at different levels of talent who will be more or less successful, and it will be more because of their resilience, but also because of their innocence and their willingness to reinvent. My whole first book is about reinvention. The whole overarching metaphor is reinvention. Right? Everything has to reinvent in real time to take out what came before. I am completely personally obsessed with the notion of creative destruction. You familiar with creative destruction? Look it up when you get home tonight. Creative destruction is the power that brings the new innovation forward to take out the old. It's what replaces the buggy whip, you know, with the car. It happens in real time, and in these product cycles, it happens in remarkably short amounts of time. If you want to stay in that game, if you want to stay in the creative destruction game, you have to find the resilience inside of you to get up every day and start and face the blank page and be courageous. And most importantly, this is probably the right place to end, other than reminding you to buy the book from Romans, nice people at Romans, I'll sign it, the most important thing. And if you take nothing else away from this talk today, I will probably sign it in your book. It's not failing if it's learning. No matter what anybody tells you, it's not failing if it's learning. Yes, if the company bets all of its assets on a single product and that product takes that company out, that that company probably needed to be taken out. But with you, there's no shame in failing unless you don't learn from it. And that's where the power of resilience comes from, and that's where the power of repeat comes from, and that's where the power of reinvention comes from. Do not fear failure. Fear not fighting hard enough. Do not fear failure. Fear not trying hard enough. Do not fear failure. Fear not educating yourself in a place where you are competitive. The internet is amazing. Anything you want to learn is at your fingertips. We didn't have this when we were kids. You can learn it. You can learn anything you want. You can come to forums like this and talk. Someone asked the other day about cross-generational, multi-generational learning. Yes, young people want to talk to you. You can talk to young people. You can learn from each other. But it's not failure if it's learning. Resilience and reinvention are your path to continued success and do it with people, products, profits, and that order. Thank you so much for sharing.